Mr. Jeremy Hardy.
Yes, sir. I am not from these parts. I am very poor. Now that the old fish mines have closed. Now, it's nice to be in the Northeast where you're just naturally, innately socialist. We have to go to university and learn it. A part of the Labour vote, alienated from Labour, will go straight from being Labour to British National Party. Which is like saying, well, I've always used a wet razor in the past, but this time I thought I'd try setting fire to my head. Because what happens is, the BNP will move into an area and they will promise people everything. Alienated people, bedraggled people who are fed up will be promised, we'll sort out all your neighbourhood issues, all the community gripes, and people are so flattered that they're being listened to that they fail to see the picture of what the BNP actually is. And they say, well, I don't agree with all their policies, but perhaps with the synagogues ablaze, the council will have to do something about the zebra crossing. Their slogan is think locally, act mentally. I do think it's fantastic that the BNP is going to be forced to admit people who aren't white. And I do urge all black and Asian people to join the BNP just to fuck with their heads. To get up at a meeting and say, people like me are genetically inferior and should be thrown out of the country. And they'll be like, I agree with... It's traumatic for them. They could have eased them into it, the BNP, by saying, first of all, they've got to admit people who aren't completely fucking mental, and just then gradually moved up to Rastafarians, you know. Every time something happens like this, the BNP get all upset. They've got an incredible sense of victimhood about it. Like, Griffin, he went on Question Time, and people had a go at him, and he came out saying, oh, I've been set up, it's not fair. He said, look, you were on telly, that was, that's enough, you've been on the telly. People know who you are, you know, it doesn't matter what more people will vote for him because he was on the telly. Didn't matter what he did, he could have gone on there and fucked a tortoise. Yeah, he would have thought it was a German helmet and put it on probably. The weird thing about fascists, about white supremacists, is their sense of victimhood. They think they are the ones who are being picked on. People in the BNP say, well, imagine if the things that are said about us were said about Muslims and asylum seekers. You think, what? That's like paedophiles say, well, how would children feel if they were on the sex offenders register? Actually, the multiracial society works. Nobody really wants it to go back to how it was before other people came here. Nobody wants to go back to a time when everything closed on a Wednesday afternoon and the whole country smelled of boiled cabbage. Nobody wants it to be like that. We like our multiracial society and we do get on. And what was striking about the 7/7 bombers was that they were British. They weren't aliens, they weren't migrants, they weren't foreign. They were ordinary British fish and chip eating, football loving lads from Leeds. That's the key thing about them, Leeds. They are miserable Yorkshire bastards. Envious of our sophisticated southern ways. My mum tells me that the first time I saw a black person in the street in our village, I said, Mummy, there is a man made of chocolate. Now, I don't believe that story. I think it's more likely that it was a man made of chocolate than a black person in Frimley Green in 1964. Methodists were still being hunted for sport. So as soon as I got the opportunity, I moved to London. I thought, I'm moving to London. I've been finished college, I'll move to London. And then suddenly it was brilliant. I thought it was brilliant because there's all these smells that I just didn't know. What is that smell? That's jerk chicken. That's Caribbean chicken, made with lots of thyme and chili. What is that? That's curry, but Indian curry. Not mum's curry, which is a sort of spicy trifle. You know, real Indian, and it's fantastic. And all the food, and then we've got every kind of restaurant. We've got Ethiopian restaurants. What happens is the food fall out of a plane, you know. And but it's not, it's like Eritrean food. But this isn't about food. I'm not just being a greedy bastard. What I'm saying is, the whole world is on your doorstep. And you say, oh, this is brilliant, I love this. And there's everything. There's Irish pubs and a Turkish community centre and an Armenian information office. And, you know, and it's just brilliant. You know, I can honestly say I've lived in London since 1982. And now I can be the only person on the bus I don't even think about it. No, not the only person on the bus, because then I'd be the driver. What I was going to say is, I can be the only person who's white on the bus, and now I don't even think about it. Conversely, if everybody on the bus is white, I'm thinking, blimey, there really are a lot of Polish people in the country. Because there are a lot of Polish people in the country, but so what? It's not a problem. I mean, sometimes it can feel a bit weird. I'll admit it can feel a bit weird when you're in the bus queue and you're listening to the accents and you suddenly think, what's happening? Everybody's Polish today. And you think, no, hang on, not everybody is Polish, because that man is black and therefore it's very unlikely that he's Polish. She looks South American, so she's probably not. I know him, he's my neighbour, he's a Muslim, they don't have Muslims in Poland. Not everybody is Polish, even though a lot of people are, but it's not a problem, is it? I mean, in Poland, loads of people are Polish and they manage perfectly well, don't they? In fact, if anything, they'd like to have more Polish people in Poland because so many have come here. But they're going back, so it's because it always sorts out. Every few years, there was this big panic about immigration. It's happening now. It happened when the Ugandan Asians came. How will we fit these people in? Oh, it's terrible. We haven't got a job. Ooh. And they fitted in and it was fine. It happened before the war. The Daily Mail campaigned to keep the Jews out up until the start of the war. People tried to keep out, you know, wave after wave. Different kind of people trying to say, you know, don't come here, don't come here. And you know, the fact is, people come and they fit in and it's fine. Under pressure from the girlfriend, I started going to the gym, which I hate so very much, because you've got to get dressed and undressed in front of other people in a similar state of disarray. And they think it's appropriate to converse. You know, I'm thinking, what? And they're standing there, like, oh, and they're cracking on about the weekend, what they can do, and like what they're going to have for Sunday dinner, their job, and how the recession has affected business, and what, you know, and how many exercises they do, and all that. And they say, I realise it's important as I get older to take care of myself. And I think, why? You work in marketing, who's going to miss you? And they're not talking about the fact that they're naked, which is the thing, you know, that most needs to be discussed at that moment. That's the thing begging to be talked about. That's the elephant in the changing room, if you will. Because people shouldn't be naked, except in very specific circumstances. Nudism is an abomination in the sight of God. It is. Nudism is like amateur dramatics. The most enthusiastic ones are the ones least worth watching. And I get on this machine where I simulate the experience of walking uphill while watching four televisions at once with no sound, thinking, this is the life. My girlfriend comes to check on me because she's been doing body balance and she wants to see how I'm getting on and if I'm doing the exercises properly. I think, look, the fact I'm here is a fucking miracle. Don't expect me to do any of it properly. And she says, you're supposed to be out of breath. I said, I'm asthmatic. We've got stairs for that. I hate it so much. The only bit I like is the resistance training. We blew up a bridge yesterday. Yeah. This is a true story. No, it's not. It's just a good joke. There's a Jewish family own a nail factory. And the father says to the son, he says, son, I'm worried about business, you know. We're not shifting nails like we should be. We're not selling nails like we should be. He says, Dad, don't worry, I'll do some advertising. So the next day, Dad turns up at the factory and there's a big advertising hoarding and on it is a picture of Jesus on the cross. And the slogan, they used Schwartz's nails. He says, son, are you a sugar? What is this? We can't have this. A lot of customers are religious. They'll be Christians. They'll be offended by this. You've got to take it down. You've got to change it. It's offensive. He says, all right, Dad, don't worry. I'll sort it. The next day, they turn up at the factory. Son's really pleased. There's a huge advertising hoarding with the cross and Jesus just slumped on the ground. And the slogan, they didn't use Schwartz's name. Anyways, I'm going to go. Do continue to help give racism the red card, because that's a good thing to be doing. And it's a bit scary. This is the first election in my life where I've thought one of the bastards might even enter Parliament. And it's a hideous thought. And if they do, then we just have to carry on fighting and show them up for who they really are. So anyway, you take care of yourself.